welcome to your National Museum of American History for what will surely be a most extraordinary evening. I'm Paula Johnson, curator of food history here, and I have to say that in a town where there are important events every day of the year, it's a rare evening in May when we can all pause to celebrate the 40th anniversary of a Michelin-starred restaurant with its charismatic founder and chef, and to do so in a way that brings together stars from the worlds of theater and journalism, all within the context of American history at the nation's History Museum. This will be a wonderful evening indeed.
That masked man who is introducing us.
What fantastic music, I must say. You know, when I was called by the Smithsonian to interview you, which I was thrilled to do, but the first thing was I said, why me? You know, why would, I'm a theater person, and why would, you know, great chef, great hotelier, what would I do? And then I thought, I got it, because I remembered my feelings when I came to the inn was that I was in the middle, from the very beginning, of an incredible romantic, musical, comedy, theater film. And from the very beginning, and I thought, well, it's just everything about it was theatrical, the way you came into the town, the way you walked into the inn, the way it looked. I mean, Little Downton Abbey, a little Arabian Nights, a little Harry Potter, a little Mary Poppins, you know, but just everything. And then the whole rest of the evening was like that. And it was witty, and it was glamorous, and it was dramatic, and it was curated, and it had somehow an arc. And I felt, well, this
at home.
My home should only look like the inn at Little Monkey. But so I understood that maybe there's a real something that we share, and quite clearly so.
Well, clearly you were able to appreciate what we do, which is very rewarding, very rewarding. Well, somebody once asked, well, what are you aiming for? And I said, well, I'd like it to feel just like going to grandmother's if grandma took acid once in a while. Mine didn't.
Well, you know, I was before we even talk about the inn and the kind of extraordinary way that it is created and is run and is, I would love to know, because when you walk in and you see that and you feel you've done it, where did that come from?
A little bit here, a little bit of there.
Well, let's talk about a little bit here and a little bit there. I mean, you know, usually somebody with that much artistic temperament that you have, in addition to all of your skills, were you like that as a kid? I mean,
I think you're asking, when did these problems begin? I think if my mother were here, she'd have something to say. In the crib, it all began in the crib.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Oh, really?
Yes. Uh-huh. Yeah.
Yes.
I realized.
I would ask you why, but that's junk.
I didn't see the universe the way my playmates saw it.
Right. What did that mean? I mean, what did you see? There's a story I wanted to ask you later.
Well, I saw what could be, what should be, what ought to be. So my very first recollection, which is, I didn't realize it was my first recollection, but I'm writing a memoir. And we were not wealthy. So I was coming down the stairs of our tenement, and I reached for the railing. I was 3 1/2, and I put my hand on this filthy, rusty railing. It was actually a pipe. That was how fancy the apartment was. And I stuck to it with layers of rust and peeling green paint, And I looked at my paw, on my hand. I knew I was a child. And I went, it's not supposed to be this way. I will design my life so that shit like this never happens. And it's taken me a long time, but I haven't touched a dirty railing in quite a few years.
But you didn't want to be a restaurateur. You didn't want to have a restaurant. What did you want to be? You didn't want to be a policeman because you didn't want any dirty fingers.
Well, I guess by the time I was around 14, they decided they should get some professional opinion about me. So I remember going to a little office that was about 10 by 10 with cinder block, and there was a psychologist in there, and I went in and sat down, and he was of Spanish descent, and he looked at me with sort of beady eyes, and he said, "Do you know that when you go to the movies, that you cannot have the gold in the movies?" It was a very primitive era. This is, we're going back in time. And I thought, this is a psychologist? And then I said, oh, yes, I can. And then I realized that the world is so full of people trying to tell you what you can't have. Don't listen.
So you didn't.
I wanted everything. Everything I ever wanted. And one day recently I said, my only regret is I didn't buy everything I ever liked because there are fewer things in life now worth buying.
You would have liked to have done it earlier.
I would have liked to have done it much earlier, much earlier. Yeah, I never knew what my diagnosis was.
Where did they find this guy? In the Yellow Pages.
No, you went to, you know, these places where you paid $2 an hour or something for help.
But did you ever want to be, you said once you wanted to be an architect, once you said you wanted to be an actor.
Well, it was an improper thing for a middle class kid at the time. Ah, thank you so much. It's always good to travel with a waiter.
I will have whatever he's having.
Well, we'll have it together. Yeah.
Okay. I should do these more often with you, Patrick.
So we're getting something nice, I think.
What is
okay.
it? Yes.
Cheers. Cheers. Mm.
Just stay out there. Yes.
The thing about theater is that it didn't anchor me quite enough. I have a tendency to be untethered. Mm-hmm. And so if you were able to get into a character, for me, it could be determined as weak technique, hard to get back out. I found that if you put a little food into the picture, if you have a big ball of dough in your hands, you are anchored to the real world.
Really?
You're not going anywhere, except in your mind.
Yes.
So food and cooking are the greatest therapy in the world.
Really?
I read in a ladies' magazine when I was about 12, if you had suicidal thoughts, bake cookies.
Oh, that's worth coming here for and going home.
You can take that with you. But then you think about, you're feeling productive, you are feeling creative, you are baking something, the whole house smells good, and then pretty soon your neighbors smell that wonderful fresh baked cookie scent, and they're there, and your friends are around.
Well,
so I've been having a house party for 40 years.
Well, that is really what you think about the restaurant, I think, that it is really yours, and it is a party for everybody. Isn't that true?
Well, that's a big key to giving the guest the feeling that they're coming to a party. The most bizarre thing is the mail comes in and there are thank you notes from our clients, a guest, and they're going on as if they were invited guests.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, but you paid a lot, I'm told.
But what do you think, why do you think that doesn't just happen automatically? No. Something you've thought about a lot.
You're tapping into a lot of zones simultaneously. So if you don't get them on one level, you're gonna get them on another level. I've got to own them before they leave. and you get there by getting into their heads and by being them. So that's what I took also from theater, the ability to erase boundaries and enter another person's psyche as you would another person's character. So even if you can do it only very briefly, it's an art that is very effective. I was told Jacqueline Onassis had the rare ability to make anyone who was at her table, who she was in a conversation with, feel like not only the only person in the world, but the most important person in the world. And that's not too difficult to do if you concentrate.
So somebody comes, and they're, of course, looking forward to it. They've driven for hours.
Or they're
staying over.
Well, they've tortured themselves no matter what.
So, and when somebody comes, do you know something about them before they show up?
Well, we're spilling secrets here. But every morning...
That's what we're here for.
Okay, all right. Every morning I receive a list with my breakfast, and it comes on a little tray. And...
Of course it does.
My dog and I sit there and we go over all the names who are coming. The addresses are also very important. So these days about 10% of our guests are either anonymous inspectors or people who we call CIPs, commercially important people who may be in the industry, they may be from Michelin, they may be somebody responding to Zagat, they may be that strange critic from the Washington Post who we never know. He's extremely successful at surprising us, and you get a little heartthrob as he enters with a fake name. So you, as one Polish general manager said to me years ago, always remember, it's their job as a critic to remain anonymous, and it's our job to know who they are. So you sort of Ouija board all these names, and you decide who is dangerous.
And do they get a little red extra mark or something?
And then you start to comb through the addresses, and sometimes you just get overwhelmed. You think, oh my God, you know, this person's coming and that person's coming, and it's all connected with big tentacles, you know, to the world. It's a world kind of theater.
Yeah.
So then you start looking at the occasions, and that just puts you in a whole different sort of frame of mind. People are coming for amazing occasions. It's the last meal, and you think, oh my God, that's a lot of pressure. Imagine making someone's last meal. I mean, they're not going to plan to expire at the end of the dinner, but it's the last great meal out, and of course...
That's wonderful for somebody to...
What could be more important than that? Yeah, yeah. So you worry. So you worry all day.
And you don't greet them with drama. Do you, I mean, you know what these events are. I have to say.
Sometimes.
I have to say in full disclosure that I had a birthday at the inn, and you must have talked to my friends.
Well, that's part of the job.
Yes, yeah. Well, so you knew
how
I liked.
How else would we get into your head?
Well. You knew I liked Venice.
Yes.
You knew I liked Maria Callas. There was a little Venetian thing out in the pool. There was Maria Callas and pictures all over the house I stayed in. And there was all this food, and then you brought a Venetian goblet, you brought the Lion of St. Mark's, and it was as though this whole restaurant was for me at that night.
That's the illusion.
Well, then I found out that
there were other people.
What, another room? Well, that's always been a problem in my life anyway. No, but I did find out because one of your staff members said that Ryan Reynolds and Blake Lively were having their wedding party in another room. And I thought, how does it all seem so personal with so many people and working so hard? So your staff must be brilliantly attuned to the way you think and feel.
They are that. It is very much a little family. I should add, we didn't know who Blake Lively was.
Well, you should ask me.
Sometimes they come in and they say, oh my God. I said, who is it? Oh, it's somebody you'd never know. It's a recent person, you know. For me, it was all about, you know, Liz Taylor, Marlon Brando. So one of our waiters, I think, to indulge me, created a little poster of all the recognizable celebrities who had been there. They didn't need a caption because just looking at their face, you knew who they were. And it filled an entire page. A third of them are dead. But they were there. And they made a real effort to come. And it's very touching to think that you can hide out, as I have, in the middle of nowhere, in a town of 133 in the mountains, and people will find you and come there.
Well,
if you do it right.
You're giving them a glorious experience and incredible food. So,
well, the food is a lure.
Well, that's interesting, because that's not usually the way a restaurant is. The food is usually it.
That's right. Most chefs' vision stops with the edge of the plate.
Right. And that's what we talk about all the time.
Yes. So my idea was everything affected me, so why wouldn't it be affecting everyone else there, and why not address it? So a friend said to me, I figured out why you're doing what you're doing. And I said, well, tell me. And he said, you couldn't get it right anywhere. So you thought if you couldn't get it, you might as well give it and set it up so you're giving it to other people.
So what was it?
What was what?
Well, what you were giving them. I mean, what we were talking about, but.
Well, you were giving them a total experience, hopefully.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
And again, we don't always succeed. But the fact that the guest knows what we're aiming for, or that we're trying to, helps make it work.
Now, when people come, do people ask sometimes for particular dinners, or do they always just take everything off the menu?
No, we call it dial a fantasy. They want anything they want, whenever they want it. And some let it be known, and others you have to read and intuit. So that's, I think, the most fun, is getting into the person's mind and listening closely to the signals, nonverbal signals, that they give off. So I sometimes say, it would be easy enough if you were going to a geisha or a very, very artistic prostitute to say, first, what I'd like you to do is the feet and shrimp my toes. And then after that, oh, I'd like you to do, but that wouldn't be any fun. What you want. What you want is not to have to say anything. Just go in, make some good eye contact, and everything will be intuited. That's the magic. That's what a great geisha is trained to do. They never take their eyes off their subject. They follow them all the time, and they make eye contact. So they're communicating a great deal. So that's another secret. Don't let that outside this room.
What if you go, the person who's staring at you all the way is not trying to steal your pocketbook.
He's feeling your vibe.
Yes, yeah. Look, you have so many people working, you have so many dinners to do, and yet you make it seem like an improvisation.
It is like a real theater. But the key is, the guest is the star performer.
Well, that's...
So, I went to a resort with a friend, and he said, these people are so stupid, they don't even know how to get out of the way. And I thought, he's right. They don't know who the guest is. They don't know which way the money flows. They don't know how they're trying to make the guest feel. So every night, it's full of corrections. Somebody is about to cut a guest off running through the kitchen. And these kids have to carry stuff through the kitchen. They have to get it out hot. But we have dining in the kitchen also. So a guest may be walking through to go to the bathroom, and they won't yield the right of way. And I meet with them privately in my elevator off the
guest.
Kitchen. No, the staff. And 10 minutes later, they come out, and they'll never make that mistake again.
I bet.
But I say, okay, look, if Queen Elizabeth was here, and she was at one time, but would you cut her off at the pass? Would you act like what you have to do is more important? Of course you wouldn't. So how can we make this woman feel like queen for a day if we act like our work is more important than acknowledging her? So this acknowledgement is key. And one of the things we do is, we've been doing it for many years, is we rate each party on a 1 to 10. Now, that's not their total net worth or anything. It is their receptivity to the experience. So
that's a sweet way of putting it, yes. What's a one?
A one is get your bulletproof vest on. Call the cops, have them standing by.
Okay, but I'm interrupting. I'm sorry.
No. What it came from was that early on, guests would say, oh, don't go near table 12. It's standard restaurant kind of talk. Don't go. Table 14 is a pain in the ass. Don't go there. What do you mean they're a pain in the ass? Oh, they're having a fight. It has nothing to do with us. And I say, but it has everything to do with us. We have 148 people working here to try to make them happy, and they're going to have a fight and a bad time. Do you think they're ever coming back? Of course they're not coming back. So turn that around. How am I supposed to do that? Well, let me show you. Do they like you? Oh, is... No. Put somebody else on the table. Put the prettiest girl. How old are they? And, you know, so you have to tell them very basic things. The young men, about 26, I say, you go out and you look at that woman like she is the hottest creature you have ever seen in your life. You admire everything about her and feast your eyes on her and turn her around. It works.
Do you have little classes for these?
Oh, yeah, sure.
Staff
sure,
to do?
Sure. One of the best classes we ever had was with Septime Weber, yes. Who was at the time director of the Washington right. Ballet. And I said, I think it's more than talking about this. They have to feel. They have to watch someone else interact in our space.
Yeah.
So the space is rather theatrical, and it was planned that way with a grand entrance to the dining room. Subtle, though. You wouldn't know it if you didn't analyze it that way. So we had the troupe come out, and first they sort of pantomimed arriving guests into our space, and our servers
really?
Seated them. And we were in awe because they were so beautiful. And then we realized that's how the space is supposed to feel. You're supposed to feel like you're making your arrival into this magical space. So then it reversed. And of course, when the ballerinas walk, they're like a floating flower arrangement. And the space changed right before our very eyes. Then when it was reversed, they became our staff. And our staff walked in, not like ballerinas.
Yeah.
And then the ballerinas greeted them. Of course, it was exaggerated. And that gets back to how I perceive the universe. in an exaggerated way.
Yeah.
So that's why I feel at home with people who exaggerate as a profession. So they then seated our guests. And it was just mind-boggling because it was 100 times more beautiful than what we were doing. And then we went next door and we had an actual dance class. And what I took away from that is that the sole purpose of the ballerone, which is a word I never had heard before, which apparently is the male dancer. The male, you have the ballerina and the male is the ballerone. His only function is, according to Septime, to make the ballerina more than she is. And for me, that was the key. All we're trying to do is make the guest feel more than they are. It doesn't mean that they're less. A ballerina is pretty gorgeous and astonishing to look at, and she's worked her whole life. But the ballerone lifts her up. She cannot stand on that toe. That's all an illusion. He's holding sometimes her entire weight. Could be as much as 102 pounds. Never more, she'd be kicked out. But that just always stuck with me, that by your through your body language, you can make someone feel very, very special and wonderful. And it's so it doesn't cost anything. That's the amazing thing about it. It's illusion and caring.
Yeah. That's, I think of the restaurants I go to where they obviously didn't take that class.
There's time for them.
And I think I'm going to come back and I'm going to have a fight with the people I'm with because I'm dying to watch somebody come and make me feel better. It's great. I don't know. I used to always think I wanted to own a restaurant when I was young because I used to sit in one all the time, and I thought, wouldn't it be great to have a restaurant and your friends could come and see you? And then most people
fun.
Said, don't
fun
you?
Is the key word.
Well, but everybody said, don't. It's the most difficult profession, and it's really hard. And anyway, I didn't, and so I do what I do. But and I go to other people's restaurants. You see it in a way that I've never ever heard anybody. I've heard people talk about their food, this is an entirely different experience. Now, let me ask you: you can't have always perfect experiences, and since you're being so frank, what's the best experience you've had? Let's start with that one. I mean, or you know, what's the best? What would be the most successful for you that you remember?
Well, something happens every night that's very touching, usually. And I think we were closed Tuesday, so it was probably Sunday or Monday. A very lovely woman and her husband came in, and she had just, I guess, passed her. There's a lot of graduations going on right now. I guess she'd just gotten her law degree from Georgetown. And she became moved during the experience. I mean, at the end of it, she was touched. She felt something. I think she wasn't entirely sure what she felt. Sometimes it's starting to get them on various levels, and then they sort of go over the falls. So, perfectly all right. So, she started crying, and that's fine. That's always wonderful. So there was nothing to do but, you know, give her a big embrace. We're in the kitchen, and things were burning all around us. But you have to stop, because nothing in the universe is more important at that moment than what she's feeling and experiencing, and she's wanting to share it. So every single human has a story. They want to tell their story. There has to be space in this interaction. They're not coming for a great meal. They are not hungry. believe me. They're coming to make a primitive physical connection with another human being, whether it be the person they came with or whether it be one of us. But telling their story is a very significant part of the process. So sometimes they don't want to tell their story to the waiter. They're speaking, maybe he's going to be jaded and he has other things to do and he's not going to listen. He won't hear them out. So they always end up dumping their story on me, sharing their story with me. And I mean, sometimes I just have to like leave the stage for just a moment and think, oh my God, what am I going to do with that one? So this one was mild. I'll tell you one that's not so mild. But she said, through tears, that this experience made her want to be a better lawyer. And I've heard that said from doctors before, too. Ultimately flattering. But one night, a woman about 40, very attractive, was in the dining room alone, which is unusual, somewhat. We tried to encourage it. She was reading a book. And she was reading along in the book, and she was a hard read because the waiters couldn't get anything out of her. Generally, in giving her a mood rating, they're trying to extract her story. She wasn't about to divulge it. So they said, we better bring her in the kitchen. She's a hard read. She's one for you. So she came in, and I said, hello, nice to see you, whatever. Cleaned my hands off. And then I happened to notice I'd read the same book. It's probably one of the two books I'd read in the last 10 years. Wasn't the Bible. At any rate, we made that spark of a connection. And then she said to me, this is my husband's 40th birthday. And I looked. She said, he died last year. And I said, excuse me. And she said, we always wanted to come here. It was a dream of ours to come. And I just said to myself, that's where I'm going anyway to celebrate his birthday. And I thought, holy Christ, imagine if she had not been able to tell the story to anybody, and she'd just gone home, and that was the end of it. So this way, she laid it on me. And it still gets to me.
I would think, of course.
Yeah.
Of course. Well, I was going to ask you what's the biggest failure you've had there, but I don't think we should end this conversation with it. Although I would love to know.
Oh, we could.
Well, did you have one? I think the bell just said we have to.
Was that a bell? I thought
something
it was
like that.
Beeping.
But you know, we didn't talk about food at all because they brought me in, and I love food, but I don't know anything more about it. So the next time you come here.
Well, ask a food question.
All right. What's the easiest thing, what's the thing all home cooks should know? Mm-hmm. And what's the easy dinner that you can make for somebody if you want them to think you're totally terrific?
That's an excellent question. By the way, we didn't rehearse anything, by the way. I had no idea what I was going to ask or where we were going.
It's an improvisation over here.
For me, the turning point in home cooking was Julia Child's title to the first book, Mastering the Art of French Cooking. So no American had ever looked at the task of cooking as mastery or as art. It just wasn't viewed that way. It was like how to sew or something. So each home cook should ultimately master the art of cooking by choosing first one dish and one dish only to become the master of, and then expand that into one three-course menu. Now, how do you do that? You make that same three-course menu every Saturday for 9 years. Look, see, you don't understand mastery. 40 years. Where were you all in 1978?
I did say sort of begin a romance, not. end one.
Well, after 9 years, you will have mastered the art of that menu.
That's the time to bring the date in.
the date, right.
9 years
but
later.
Your friends will think you are the greatest cook in the state because you make, and you also can produce that entire thing in 15 minutes. Then you move out into other sort of arenas of the, those same dishes. Then you'll have the confidence. Confidence is not easy to gain. Time is an important consideration. Somebody once said, why is it that people don't think it unusual, if you're going to study the violin or master the violin, to spend 8 years doing it? But they want to go home with a recipe and produce perfection one time, the first time. It doesn't work that way. It's not hard, but it's hard to do it in a way that makes it part of you. So years and years ago, I was asked to speak at the Culinary Institute of America to give a cooking demonstration. So I arrived and I thought I'd do something a little bit different. And I said, I'm going to show you a tool that you've never probably fully appreciated in your life. We had a drum roll and we started pulling it out of a giant instrument case, and it was a broom. And I said, I'm sure you've seen this before, but never known its full potential. Then I threw some dirt on the floor that I'd brought from home. And I said, I want you to watch me very carefully as I sweep. And at the moment that I become the broom, I want you to raise your hand. And I began sweeping. And then the moment came. I was at one with the broom. I was sweeping consciously. So I said, if you can sweep consciously, you can do anything. If you can learn how to become at one with something. So I said, that's the secret to unlocking the mystery of cooking. You have to get in the oven with that roast. And be at one.
Well, that's actually wonderful. No,
but
it's
a little better ending note, right?
No, but I also think it's actually the truth about any art. And
yes.
I think what you do is art, and thank you for it too. So.
Thank all of you. Thank you, Smithsonian. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
What advice would you give to a guest that wants to connect with the inn and get the most out of their experience?
That's a wonderful question, and I'm actually writing another book called Diner's School, and it came about because sometimes waiters say, not obnoxiously, but they'll say, oh God, table 14 didn't go to diner school, and they're very forgiving, but they just wish they knew certain basic tricks to dining. First of all, be the star. Know which way the money flows. It's all about you. But we have, for example, some old school guests, one woman in particular. Whenever she's about to come to the inn, she writes this sweet little note on beautiful stationery, and she tells who she's bringing. And it's sometimes an ambassador or somebody important. And then she tells that or it could be an anniversary or something like that. She shares her occasion and implies the expectation. And of course, you don't sleep the night before because you're worried about, you know, she's coming and you know how much it means to her. The other great thing is to enter with a smile and to realize that these people are not your adversaries. They have spent their lives trying to make people happy. That's what they want to do. They want you to be happy. So enter with a smile. Say something flattering about the restaurant, like, I've always wanted to come here. You know, we're so thrilled to finally be here. It means so much to my wife is having her 100th birthday tonight. And you say, damn, she doesn't look a minute over 99. You have to be a participant in the dance. It's an interactive dance. You're either the ballon or the ballerina. So go for it.
Great, thank you. One more question.
Congratulations on your achievement of 40 years of having your wonderful restaurant. Thank you. And you seem to be a pretty exacting person. And I was just wondering, I was just wondering if you had a figure for the number of dinners that you have served over the 40 years.
Well, we thought of doing that big arch out front. And then somebody tried to calculate the number.
Over
and I got,
how many billion served?
Yeah, that's right. And I got very tired just thinking about that. One little plate at a time. We've never attempted to calculate, and I think it's maybe wise that we don't.
Okay.
But hopefully we've made some people happy along the way. And they do come back.
Absolutely.
And now we're welcoming a second and third generation, which is extremely rewarding. A guest was dining in the kitchen the other night, and he was proposing to the young lady, and they were in their 20s. And I went over and he said, my parents first brought me here when I was 5. And another young woman came into the kitchen and she said, my mother said to be sure and say hello. She told me I was conceived here.
Yes.
I blushed. I said, did she tell you what room? Yes, room 5.
Thank you. Patrick O'Connell. Yes. Congratulations on 40 years. There will be many more to come, I'm sure.